Welcome back to the DoD Risk Management Framework Series. I'm Mike Redmond, walking you through step-by-step your successful implementation of the DoD Risk Management Framework. We've made it to the end. Step 6, the monitor step. The goal of this section is for you to be able to manage, control, and document changes to your information system and its environment. Implement the correct forms and patches when the situation calls for it. Select or support the selection of the appropriate assessment roles. State the characteristics of good performance measures and report or react to the reporting of vulnerabilities and mitigation, as well as knowing how and when to decommission an information system. For those of you studying for the ISC squared CAP exam, review the requirements of the continuous monitoring of system controls. This is a vital step in the risk management framework. So within the monitor step, there are 7 core tasks: information system and environment changes, ongoing security control assessment, ongoing remediation actions, key updates, security status reporting, ongoing risk determination and acceptance, and information system removal and decommissioning. So let's begin by setting some rules for continuous monitoring. First, near real-time risk management. Next, ongoing updates to the security plan, the SAR or Security Assessment Report, and the POAM. Next, reducing the level of effort needed for reauthorization, remembering the goal is continuous authorization. And finally, scaled with the information system's impact level. First, we'll look at the information system and environment changes. This is where we identify and document and conduct the impact analysis. We identify corrective actions for the information system itself and ensure that all appropriate documentation has been revisited. The primary task owner here is the information system owner and the common controls provider. So when we begin the configuration management process, everyone thinks, of course, of tools, of computers, of monitoring. And one of the tools available to you is the Security Content Automation Protocol, or SCAP. It's a suite of specifications for ongoing and expressing security-related information in a standardized way. You should ensure that all your system administrators and network administrators, ISSOs, and so forth, are familiar with and use the SCAP viewer. You can download it from isc.disa.mil. So the attempt and the desire is to automate as much as possible. To do this, we have several tools and references to data sources, like SCAP, which we just talked about. What can be automated with SCAP and how it is to be implemented is going to differ from organization to organization. Remember, the SCAP tool will only be able to look at the system configuration itself. It cannot make a determination on the environment that the system lives. Next, you'll have National Vulnerability Database data, the NVD, plus security configuration checklist. Some people will call this the secure vendor baseline. Again, these are just tools to help automate as much as possible the continuous monitoring step. Understand that SCAP is there to complement security assessments, make them faster and more efficient, not replace them. Automated reporting and monitoring is still a requirement, and many organizations are still trying to figure this part out. Some use, for instance, EMAS for system status, and then, for instance, ACAS and Nessus for vulnerability scanning. Understand, again, these are just simple tools. They're dumb tools. They don't know where the system is. 70% of continuous monitoring is, in fact, physical. That brings us to the Open Checklist Interactive Language. It's a partially automated monitoring solution with the express determination of statements in a format compatible with SCAP. So when we talk about continuous monitoring, what are we really saying? We're identifying the organization's overall risk tolerance or appetite. We identify the enterprise architecture itself, the security architecture, as well as security configurations, plans for changes to the enterprise architecture, and any available threat information. Remember, it is cyclical. Define, establish, implement, analyze and report, respond, and review and update. So, since we're here, we'll talk about the overall role of automation within a continuous monitoring plan. Be sure to give all due consideration to the proper tools, ensuring that they're capable of pulling information from a variety of resources to identify specific specifications and mechanisms in the information system itself. Using open specifications such as SCAP is important, especially for interoperability, and ensure that whatever tool you select can support overall compliance with any applicable federal laws, regulations, standards, or guidelines. This is especially important when dealing with, for instance, privacy data and health data. And of course, it should go without saying that any continuous monitoring tool should be able to provide reporting with the ability to tailor that output. And you should consider whether or not the tool is capable of data consolidation inside of a SIM tool. Here's a list of some other sources and technologies that you should be familiar with within continuous monitoring, such as the CWE, or Common Weakness Enumeration, or the CWSS, the Common Weakness Scoring System, or the CAPSE, the Common Attack Pattern Enumeration and Classification, and the MALIC, the Malware Attribute Enumeration Characterizations. These are some outstanding tools and resources that provide valuable input to system vulnerabilities. Next, we'll deal with ongoing security control assessments. Again, a core element in ongoing authorization. This simply indicates that each security control should be addressed as a subset to the whole. It should not be done once a year, but on a rotating basis. It should also be done or assisted with independent assessors. We spoke about how to identify independence with your validators, and then always keep a history and reuse prior assessment results. It gives you an indication as to the overall health over the information system's lifetime. Are you getting better or are you getting worse? And like with any other criteria, whatever criteria you assess by, it must be performance-based, measurable. What we look for when we look at performance measures are quantifiable information based on readily attainable data, repeatable information, useful for tracking the overall performance as well as directing resources. Next, we have our ongoing remediation actions. This is your POAM. This is maintaining the health status and plan of action and milestones to correct weaknesses as they are identified not only in the risk assessment, but through ongoing control assessment as they occur over the course of the information system's life cycle. The primary owner of this task, again, is the information system owner and the common controls provider. Next, you have your status reporting. This is the update of the POAM. New vulnerabilities are identified all the time. Once they are identified, see if they apply to your information system, and if they do, make an entry in the living POAM. It's not a bad thing to have issues that you need to work through a plan of action and milestones. It's only bad when you ignore it. Again, all of this feeds into the utopian goal of ongoing risk determination and acceptance, the goal of not having to do the 36-month fire drill over and over again. If we do an adequate job of continuous monitoring, looking at security controls in a cyclical fashion, we can reach the goal of ongoing authorization. And finally, we have information system removal and decommissioning. This is a tricky step sometimes because we really don't like throwing things away. way. However, reuse is kind of the same as decommissioning, but remember, everything has a life cycle. Everything should be born and then eventually die, making way for newer, better technologies, processes, and procedures. One of the key aspects when it comes to system decommissioning is media sanitization. How are you going to do it? Remembering that different media requires different types of attention. For instance, some data might be on magnetic media versus optical versus electrical. Other media might be on hard copies or electronic copies. How are you going to get rid of it? It must be identified, for instance, in the continuous monitoring plan. Not only how the machine is going to live, but how the data ultimately is going to be disposed of. When it comes to disposal, there are five key parts. The building and execution of a disposal plan. The information preservation steps, media sanitization, hardware and software disposal, and then system closure. When it comes to sanitization decisions, first you must consider the security categorization. Some media and some mediums can be disposed of in some fashions and others in another. Then looking at the cost-benefit analysis. Do you really need to reuse that hard drive, or is it just more cost-effective to destroy it and buy a new one? Are there any environmental factors that you need to take into account? For instance, the type and size of the media storage itself, any confidentiality of the data stored, internal sanitization and external issues that might arise, the volume of the media that needs to be accounted for, and the level of training for sanitization personnel. It is sometimes a very specific skill when it comes to getting rid of data. And then finally, the potential for reuse or recycling. Like I said, sometimes and most often, hard drives don't need to be recycled. Hard drive space is cheap. Sometimes it's just best to destroy the hard drive and get a new one rather than risk cross-contamination, regardless of the sensitivity of the data. Well, there we have it. We've reached the end. All six steps. I'm sure you were taking notes as you went, and now you're ready to go out and tackle the risk management framework. Some final parting thoughts for you. The risk management framework itself can look daunting. It can look like a large mountain to climb. However, when you really get into it, it's not that difficult. Sure, there are lots of moving parts, but once we get the entire security community wrapped around their processes and their pieces, it all actually does move very smoothly. But that requires everyone to do their part. This is no longer just IT's problem. This is the entire organization's issue. I'm sure that you will be successful. However, if you do need help, feel free to reach out anytime. Good luck. I'll see you next time.